So welcome, thank you for coming. I only have 7 hours of remarks, so I thought I ought to start a little early. We are going to begin now. I hope as people come in, they'll feel comfortable grabbing food and you won't mind going back to get seconds. We will keep covenant and end at 2 o'clock, but we're going to organize this a little differently today because the question of a mission trip is so context dependent. And you're going to have a lot of things that you do at your church that are different than what we do at our church. We're going to be doing things at our church that don't translate even as idea generators. So we're going to organize it a little bit more as a workshop so that I'll present some idea generators and then leave you 10 or 15 minutes to talk at table so that you can swap ideas and then we'll come back. All right, let me say table grace. Gracious God, for the new beginnings that constantly come from your hand, for the new beginnings of a new year, for the opportunity to gather and break bread together and fellowship together, we thank you for all these. We pray that in our time together, old friendships will be renewed and new friendships started. We pray that you'll bless to us a sense of your Spirit guiding us as we seek and ask how to minister to your children. We ask for all this as we ask for a blessing on this food and the hands that prepared it. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, here's how we're going to start. We're going to just start with a little last clip from our mission trip at our church last year to Biloxi, Mississippi. We had gone on a mission trip there right after Hurricane Katrina. You all know that they're not beginning to be done with rebuilding in places like East Biloxi. So we went back last year and we partnered with 25 local churches and 9 churches hosted our teams. That resulted in a final celebration and worship, and you're just going to see a bit of that with voiceovers from our kids. And if you pay attention to these 5 minutes, you don't need to listen for the rest of the day because our kids will teach you better than I can teach you, all right? Here it is. I've got a better way to use our time than that. As moving and evocative as that. Okay. Right.
No, it's not quite it, though.
Okay, here's what I'll do while we're getting organized. This is what happens when a 62-year-old tries to have technology in the middle of a talk. I have some thank yous. The binders that you've got before you, the DVDs that have all the documents in the binder in digital form, and then more. These have been put together by some really hardworking people. Kim, who is back there, Kim Case, was a senior in our youth group 5 years ago and is back helping out. Kelly Morrissey and Lee Engen all had a hand in that. At your tables, many of you have folks who have worked with our youth group or are currently Youth Ministry Initiative Fellows. Would you folks raise your hands if you're at a table somewhere? It's not so that they can tell you more about our program. Kelsey, you should be sitting somewhere else. Why double up over there? Chris? No. When we have our breakouts, if you have questions, they'll just try to keep the conversation going. And I want to thank Joe Britton for the opportunity to have this program. He helped us get a foothold on the Yale campus when we taught at the Berkeley Divinity School last year. And I get to do this because Miroslav Wolf welcomed us into the Yale Center for Faith and Culture. So Miroslav, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. All right, I'm going to start with, we're going to race through this outline in sections. And here's the question. I'm at a habitat site on a workday for something we sponsored in Bridgeport. And one of my shrewd business colleague types who works downtown was working with me. And he said, you know, I would feel more comfortable about making donations to your youth group if you were more efficient in the way you got the work done. I mean, I don't understand why we're spending all this money on transportation and food and housing. Why don't you just put the kids in a bus in the morning and bring them up to Bridgeport? All that money could go into houses. What's the right answer to that question? Why bring them up in buses at all? Why don't we just cut a check, right? If the efficiency question is, how do we generate the most construction for folks who need it in a world that has marginalized them or left them without housing, we should simply raise money and send a check to qualified professional contractors who need the work in the community. They will get more done than we get done by going on a mission trip, right? The dirty little secret of mission trips, I don't put this at the top of my fundraising letters, is there will never ever be a mission trip where as much work would be done as we could have accomplished if we had just sent them a check for the airfare, the housing, the train, the vans, or whatever. We don't go on mission trips just, or maybe even principally, to build houses. We would send checks if that's what we were principally about. Which raises the question, why do we go on mission trips? Why do we take people on mission trips? Now, I didn't think about that when I ran my first mission trip. I was a student intern here in at Yale, and I was working out at the First Congregational Church in Guilford. They did mission trips. Let's do mission trips. Okay, you do mission trips. And I just kind of went with the program. But if you think about it for even just a couple of moments, I think you'll realize that, well, if we're going to go to this work, we ought to do theological reflection before we go as to what our purpose is. You all know the cliche, but I think it's worth reading out from Alice in Wonderland. Alice says, "Mr. Cat, which of these paths shall I take? Cheshire Cat, well, my dear, where do you want to go? Alice, I don't suppose it really matters. Cheshire Cat, then, my dear, any path will do. I promised you a nuts and bolts talk, but nuts and bolts are going to be entirely different depending on why you're going on your mission trip. We ought to be doing some reflection why we go, because the why will drive the how, right? The why will drive the how. More importantly than that, when you think about it, your mission trip sits in the middle of or at the end of your youth ministry year. Actually, I think before you reflect on why you do a mission trip, you should reflect on why you do youth ministry, because this is one of the most powerful experiences you're going to have embedded in your youth ministry. So I think the reflection backs up. Why do we do youth ministry? What is our mission in doing youth ministry? That will inform why we do mission trips, and that will inform how we do mission trips. Are we ready? We're going to try this film again. Again, this will cover everything I'm going to say for the next hour.
Unconditional love, and basically everyone on the trip, even if you don't know them, you're gonna love them unconditionally, you're gonna accept them for who they are, and you actually get to know people really well on the trip.
It's YG tradition to end the mission trip with a final celebration. We do this to express gratitude to God and the Biloxi community. It's also a time to celebrate, play, sing, and worship alongside new friends, and to reflect on the most amazing moments of the trip.
The end of the work week, you get to look back on all the things that you've done, and that's pretty good. But you realize that the best part about your week has been connecting with the people and helping in any little way you can. I think that's what Hope CDA is really all about. Neighbors helping neighbors and people coming together. That is what a mission trip is really all about.
The most powerful moment I experienced God's presence on the trip was the final celebration when we were all sitting in a circle and we were singing Amazing Grace, and everyone just kind of closed their eyes, held hands, and we all just became one community. Only like God could bring us together like that.
I think the service we did in Biloxi is important because we're not only helping to rebuild homes, but we're helping rebuild the community there. It's really hard for a community to hold together all its bonds just by helping to make the community stronger. So vital.
I don't think my sense of spirituality necessarily changed on the trip. I think it became stronger because it's such a community and there's so much time to recognize God's grace. It definitely like increases your sense of spirituality and how like God is always there for you, especially in our church when the whole group is together.
The most valuable thing for me was learning that unconditional love does exist. We spoke about that so much on the trip, but it just hit home so hard for me. And I just felt it all the time. I felt it during the worship service. I felt it with my team every single day. And it just blew my mind. It makes you feel so light and full at the same time. And I was just so happy because I don't think I've ever felt pure unconditional love before this trip.
So if what we're seeking is why do we do youth ministry, so we know why we do mission trips, so we know how we do mission trips, I have an acknowledgement, a challenge, and an introduction. Here's the acknowledgement. There is no one universally accepted theology of why we do youth ministry. Depending on our traditions, our churches, our histories, they're all over the lot. I've given you 7 or 8 different articulations, but you can well imagine how the articulation is going to drive the reason to do youth ministry trips, which is going to drive how you do the trips. That's the acknowledgement. Here's the challenge. I want to just provocatively poke at a couple of ways that I've seen we end up often doing mission trips that are not necessarily driven by our theology and our mission of youth ministry. One of them is the add-on mission trip. The add-on mission trip is a church comes to me and says, we're really looking to build our youth ministry. We'd love to learn from you. I say, well, how are you doing? How's your youth ministry going? They say, well, we get about 5 kids a week, but we get 60 kids on the mission trip. I said, well, do you ask the kids on the mission trip to come to the youth group as part of the condition of going on the trip? Oh, no, they wouldn't do that. And what would you say to the parents? They've got so much to do with soccer games and SAT prep courses and tutoring. They have essentially made the mission trip an add-on to their youth group year, and therefore they have stripped out the integration, the theology, the practices, the relationship building of the year. And no, it's not true that they won't come. We have incrementally increased the covenantal expectations of our kids, and we've gone from 17 kids on the mission trip to 150 a year. They will come. In fact, the more depth that you add to the program, the more meaning that you add to the program, the more the relationships deepen, the more they will make the time to come. So that's the add-on mission trip. The apart from or separate mission trip, often it's what we can do. We don't have the staff to run a mission trip. We don't have the resources to run a mission trip. And we send the kids to a mission trip facilitator. Okay, if that's driven by necessity, I get it. But if you have the resources to make it an integral part of your youth ministry year, I think you're selling off your birthright for a mess of porridge. Or here's a third one. It's the third one is instead of youth ministry. We've got a terrific youth group, and we've got 75 kids who go on mission trips, but we realize that if we didn't impose Christian doctrine and practices, even more kids would feel comfortable. And therefore, we've gotten our mission trip up to 125 kids who are doing service learning and relationship building. That's terrific. And then actually, we found they were uncomfortable coming during the year when we had Christian content. So we dropped the Christian content during the year. And we have made the year mission trip preparation for the mission team. Once again, I get it, but I think we're selling our birthright and stripping out our youth ministry of one of the most important drivers of youth ministry and formation for our group. Okay, that's the challenge. Here's the introduction. Obviously, our nuts and bolts, our hows, are going to be driven by why we do mission trips, which is driven by our theology of youth ministry. And we are time sensitive, so I worked that out in a lecture to the Berkeley Divinity School Colloquium last year. It's in your first tab. You can get the long form there. I've embedded a bunch of quotations so that you can see how we got there here. But because Miroslav's here, I just want to tell three quick Yale vignettes because some of you have been in this room before, and so we'll just call down the spirit of Yale Divinity School for a second. Here's what I remember from Leander Keck. This used to be the common room, right? We would gather in here before we'd go to the refectory. Leander Keck, amazing theologian, dean of the Yale Divinity School, dean of the Vanderbilt Divinity School, professor of New Testament, was teaching the Gospel of John one day, and he said, look, I think I can summarize the Gospel and the three letters. This is the way the theologian who was the evangelist evolved over the course of his career with his community. When he began, his theology was blah, 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 love, blah, 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 love, blah, 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 love. By the time he got to his first letter, he had aged and had some more experience in ministry. By the time of his first letter, the theology of the evangelist was blah, blah, love, blah, blah, love, blah, blah, love. And by the time he got to his third letter at the end of his career, it was love, 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 love. All right. A Miroslav Volf vignette. One of the great things about having a speaker come and join you for a series is you get to give them homework. And so Miroslav was coming down to try out some lectures that would become his book free of charge. And that means I'm going to take him out to dinner. That means what's the one question you want to ask the greatest theologian in the world if you got him stuck at dinner? So I thought about that a lot, and I've got him stuck at dinner, and there's really no way he can escape. And I said, you know, I have read Paul Tillich say that the experience of grace is intermittent and fragmentary. Our encounters with the spiritual reality, intermittent and fragmentary. You know, that seems like kind of small gruel. I mean, I know that grace means there's nothing we can do, it's unmerited, but is there anything we can do to make the ground better soil? And he said, I suppose the Theologica Germanica has something to say about that. Well, Theologia Germanica is what trips off his lips, but what I'm going is, what did he just say? What is the Theologia Germanica? So I acted, you know, I didn't want him to realize how poorly educated I'd been at Yale, so I didn't say anything. But as soon as I got back to my office, I Googled it, of course, and up came a book that was Martin Luther's favorite devotional work and his favorite book other than the Bible and Augustine, an anonymous 13th century German author's devotional writing. And here's the gist of the book. On the first page, the author says, when we ask why we do not experience God, it makes no more sense than why the blind man should ask why he does not see the sun. The sun is always present. It's his blindness that obscures the sight. What is it about us that is blind and obscures the sight? An incredibly modern kind of idiom. The me, the mine, and the my. The turn to self is what obscures the experience of God. And much of our devotional practice and theology is to turn from self back to God and neighbor. Well, these ideas had much to do with informing our sense of mission. And so the other thing I'd want to say is, do you remember when Andy Root was with us? Andy Root last year spoke on relationship, and he said, here's where the love and the relationship needs to be reflected upon. We should not be loving kids so that they learn the Bible. We should not be loving kids so they become disciples of Christ. We should not be loving kids so they don't do drugs. All these are good things. That's not what Jesus would do. He would just love them. That's what we should be doing. We should be just loving them where they are. Authentic, not instrumental relationship. Let me give this a slight twist in the other way. You know, when the scribe encounters Jesus in chapter 22 of Matthew, teacher, what is the greatest commandment? We all know what the answer is, right? Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, neighbor as thyself. What if there'd been a follow-on question? What if the follow-on question was, teacher, what is the greatest commandment for youth ministry? What do you think Jesus would have said? Turn them into church attenders. I don't think so. I think it would have been, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, thy soul, thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. So, if you turn to page 6, You'll have one story that captures out of one of our kids' mouths why we do mission trips and why we do youth ministry. The child says, I get an email from the mom, says, my two boys, my twins were home right after the mission trip, and I just couldn't understand why they were so lit up and what happened. And they struggled to explain to me what it was. And they said, Mom, for 10 days, we loved unconditionally, supported one another. There was no judgment. There was no criticism. There was nothing but loving each other. And we knew that love came from God. And we went back to school today, and it was so hard back at school. We had a teacher in math who was just beating on us and criticizing us and belittling us. So my brother and I went up to her after class and we said, it doesn't have to be like this. We have seen and we have lived another way to live. We just spent 10 days working in the rain. Nobody judged, nobody criticized, only love. We knew the love came from God. We got every single thing done that was, you don't have to teach like this. We don't have to be like this. And the teacher looked up and said, I understand what you're saying. And she smiled, and then she started to cry, and then she said, I'll do it differently tomorrow. That's why we do mission trips. So you can see our mission statement, which is principally, we will foster a community in which our youth may experience and share the love of God, and then a community in which that is characterized by unconditional love and acceptance, by clear and understandable boundaries and covenants, and by participation in something larger than yourself. That's what drives our how. Now, of course, you don't have to reflect on it for a second to know that's not actually their culture at the high school. So we are talking about what Paul was talking about, be ye not conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds. Youth ministry is about nurturing that community, so that there may be a presence of the living Christ Spirit that is transformative in their walk. And that gets into, well, where does transformation come from? And one of my more amazing buddies here at the Divinity School in 1993 had this resume. Think if you know anybody with this resume. Grew up in a martial arts family, enlisted in the Green Beret, fought in Vietnam, decided that it turned out the Green Beret was not the most demanding and the toughest, it was the Navy SEALs, finished his tour, went back to San Diego, became a Navy SEAL, fought in Vietnam, then fought in Afghanistan with the Mujahideen on the side of the Shiites, came out of Afghanistan and had a conversion experience and went to Harvard Divinity School to learn theology, came here to become an Episcopal priest. I said, this guy knows something about transformation. So I said, Shannon, sometimes we preach and we preach and we teach and we teach and we're not sure there is transformation. What did you learn? I think I missed the 3 years he spent in the Shaolin Buddhist monastery in China. He said, actually, we know exactly how transformation works. We know it in a Green Beret boot camp. We know it in SEAL training. We know it at law schools, at medical schools. Everywhere we really care about transformation, we know how to do it. You take the person out of their comfort zone, away from their home, into the counterculture, strictly reinforcing the mutual values of that culture, give them a different look, a different life that is destabilizing, but eventually becomes transformative, and then they go home with the transformation in place. We've seen this before, right? The Navy SEALs did not invent this. This is what pilgrimages have been for thousands of years. This is what the pilgrims do on the Compostela pilgrimage. This is what the pilgrims do on the Lord's pilgrimage. This is what the pilgrims did in the Middle Ages when they went to Rome or Jerusalem or wherever. How far back does this notion of pilgrimage go in our tradition? Jesus is obviously a pilgrim, enters Jerusalem as a pilgrimage, the Eucharist is a pilgrim's meal. Moses is a pilgrim. People of Israel are pilgrims. Abraham's a pilgrim. Transformation has always come to people in motion. So we have this lovely quotation from H. Richard Niebuhr, who also haunted this room at one time. Pilgrims are persons in motion, passing through territories not their own, seeking something we might call completion, or perhaps the word clarity will do as well, a goal to which only the Spirit's compass points the way. And then I've got two great books for you if you want to dig down into the notion of mission trip as pilgrimage. The first is Trevor Hudson, A Mile in My Shoes, Cultivating Compassion. And the other is Don Richter, Mission Trips That Matter, Embodied Faith for the Sake of the World. Great line from Trevor Hudson, which we teach all our kids, and it's the touchstone at the beginning of our mission trips. We would come as pilgrims, not tourists, as learners, not as teachers, as receivers, not as givers, as listeners, not as talkers. All right? We need to get over the notion that a mission trip is about incredibly well-resourced, talented, sophisticated first-world people going to save, enlighten, and change and enrich second-world or third-world people. We go because they have much to teach us, much to give us, much that God will give us both in the encounter. All right? That's what drives our mission trips. All right. We're going to take a break. It's time for a little workshop experience. Hold that. A little workshop experience. We'll give you 5-10 minutes. What drives youth ministry at your church, and how does your theology of youth ministry drive your theology of mission trips, and then how does that get instantiated where you are? Enjoy. We will do another breakout. I'm sorry that we're so pinched for time. All right. I'm going to quickly cover the topic on page 13. Once you have a theology of youth ministry, which drives the reason you do a mission trip, you're going to want to integrate the two. One less serious, one more serious comment. The less serious comment. Anybody here old enough to have had Mattel Hot Wheels? All right. But the coolest part of the Mattel Hot Wheels, which is a little car that low friction flew around a track, had a loop-de-loop. But for that car to make the loop, it had to go through the supercharger, all right, or the turbo booster, all right? A mission trip is a supercharger or turbo booster to your youth group year, all right? Your youth group year lays down foundations of practices and relationships and shared songs and stories that then make your mission trip so much richer. And your mission trip is your youth ministry distillate or concentrate that gives you the time and attention and the attention units to ground and deepen all of those things. Remember when Roger Nishioka came, he said, for true relational authenticity to be established, you need 17 contiguous hours with the same human beings. Whoa, 10 days, 24/7? That's turbocharge. That's super booster, all right? So the two should be integrated. You can see here how we integrate our mission trip into our youth group year, intentionally building and laying down foundations. I think maybe the most important of them, aside from relationship, are the practices. The practices. The first mission trip I took, I can still remember, we got to West Virginia, and I took them into the local church. Boy, do these kids hate being in that local church. They stood there awkwardly, they kind of didn't know the songs, they looked down and they mumbled the songs, etc. Well, you can't expect it to be different on the mission trip if you haven't been in regular worship during the year. Regular prayer, regular worship, regular devotionals during the year create the appetite, the custom, the expectation to do it on the mission trip itself. So we have regular worship in our youth group. We have regular singing of the songs, their own hymns, etc. Regular praying for one another. That grounds the experience of the mission trip, and then the mission trip turbocharges it when it comes home. The other way of saying that is what you do in practice, you do in the game. Right? What you do in practice, you do in the game. No practice, no game. If you want covenantal behavior on the mission trip where everybody pitches in, don't let them go home every night with the place a mess while you clean up the hall. They need that covenantal behavior all year long if you expect to get it on the mission trip. All right, now, you're saying I drove a long way here and I paid so much money as a ticket to this room and lunch was very expensive. How am I going to redeem this expense? I'm going to redeem it for you right now, all right? Redeem it. I think the most powerful driver of our youth ministry, we fell into quite accidentally, senior leadership, all right? 10 minutes, senior leadership. We have a commissioning of the seniors on the mission trip, a laying on of hands and prayers and reflections by the younger kids. This is a child reflecting the next day on what she said to the seniors the night before.
The other night, and everyone was so happy for the seniors, and the first thing that came to my mind when I thought of them that was, no matter what I do, whenever I'm walking through the hallway at the high school and I look up and I see a YG senior, I know that they have the biggest heart that any person could ever have. They're so loving and caring, and whether I know them or not personally, that they'll always be wonderful to me.
All right, senior leadership. My first mission trip in 1995, I had the immense misfortune of following this guy, who was a younger man back in 1991,
yes,
who had been the youth minister before me. But he left, and we got a Yale intern who came in. So when I came in, I was the third youth minister that youth group had in 3 years. All but two of my seniors dropped out. Why should they stay? Develop a relationship with yet another guy. I've already been on three mission trips. And, oh, by the way, I think I got my mom conned into me and my girlfriend's going to Cancun on a senior trip. No mission trip for us. One of only two seniors who stuck with me was Lee Engen, who is our director of youth ministry and outreach, etc. We go off on the mission trip. No senior leadership, no exemplars of what the behavior should be. Of course, I got the results of that. Chasing the kids down all night to try to get them to go to bed. Find a kid in a car coming back at 11:45 at night with one of the young, cool contractors of the mission center. They'd been out smoking dope. And we find three juniors in a freshman girl's room. All right, cops and robbers all week long. Cops and robbers all week long. Which is the culture at the high school. Band trip, cops and robbers. Sports trips, cops and robbers. And that's what's going to be your youth ministry trip if we don't change the culture. All right, second year. We've got seniors, and they're beating on me. We want to stay up. And I'm going, hey, we got to be rested tomorrow. We got to stay up. I can't stay up with you. I'm an old man. I'm too tired. It's 11 o'clock. I need to go to bed. And Kate Hyde and Theo Avgerino said, you go to bed. You tell us what time you want them in bed. We'll put them down. I said, I can't get them down. They run me ragged with cops and robbers. They trust us. Give us one night. What time do you want them to go to bed? I said, what time do you want to go to bed? They go, 12 o'clock. I said, done. I go to bed at 11 o'clock going, man, this might be my last night of youth ministry, right? I'm going to wake up tomorrow like Gulliver, right? Tied down. You think those kids went to bed at 12 o'clock? All a senior has to say to a kid who is acting up is go, dude, that ain't cool. Done. It's done. It's over. You do not mess with seniors. Now, I would have been glad to have any leadership cadre, and maybe your culture is different. I had a phenomenal leader who was a junior. I said, you should be leading this group. She goes, that's not our school. No one will accept my leadership. It has to be a senior. Okay, senior leadership. Next year, I started cultivating the four seniors to be senior leaders. They said, nobody respects us. They won't listen to us. They don't really look up to us. I don't think this is going to work. I said, just try it. You will be amazed that if you pour yourself out, Philippians 2, 5 through 11, kenosis him, pour yourself out for these kids. The amount of love that's going to come washing back is going to amaze you. They did it. They were awkward. They were insecure. They didn't think they were making a difference. We got to the final reflection, the candles passing, and Kendall Levin says, I just want to say something to the seniors. You have loved us. You have cared for us. You have taught us. We love you so much. We're going to miss you so much next year. We will never forget you. Four seniors in the middle of a circle, crying their eyes out, 20 kids around them, giving them a group hug. Every senior there said, I'm doing this again. And every kid who was there said, when I be a senior, I'm going to do that, right? So we have intentionally nurtured that senior leadership program. And you can see all built around the ethos of Philippians 2, 5 through 11. The basic bottom line is this. You are charismatic, you are wonderful, you are theologically deep, you are a transformative leader, and because you are all those things, you will be able to lift your youth group to a 7 on a scale of 10 just by brute leadership charisma. You can't get past that unless the kids own their own group. Nobody gets to a 10 without the youth group owning its own leadership, all right? So, you can see the little checklist. I'm going to just race through them. In August, we have a senior retreat. We take the seniors on a 3-day whitewater camping, etc. The job of the retreat is discern how you are called by God to put your stamp on this year. What does this year mean for you when you are senior leaders? They have their own Facebook page. They have senior meetings on the mission trip to govern the trip. They prepare for the year's first youth group meeting, and then we come to a point in the meeting. We pull all the advisors out. It happens to be at a beach. All the advisors walk away. The seniors are taking you down the beach, and they're going to tell you where they're taking you this year. Well, you know, this senior leadership program with this kind of ownership has grown from those four. We have 52 senior leaders this year. That's 1/6 of the high school is a senior. And when you are a freshman and you see that there are 52 seniors are going to know who you are. I was walking behind two freshman kids on a retreat one time, and I heard them say to another, when we get back from this retreat, seniors are going to know our names. All right? Seniors take care of the younger kids, and we flip the status system, right, which is essential to pilgrimages, this liminal subversion of the usual status that goes on pilgrimage. Seniors eat last. Seniors shower last. Seniors don't ever sit gunshot. Seniors don't run the music. Seniors are servants, and that's what keeps them. Because the talk to the seniors is, you know what, just your fourth mission trip, why go? Another year, why go? Hanging around with 14-year-olds. You know what the age difference between a 14-year-old boy and a 17-year-old girl is? 37 years, right? There's no draw in one more turn of the wheel, but you say, this is going to be the most amazing year for you ever. You're going to live this Philippians 2, 5 through 11, and you're going to see that the you that takes you down in service is going to result in more amazing experiences of God and love than you've ever had. You are being handed by God kind of a magic wand. Your attention in the hallways at school, your favor, your interest, your engaging and investing in a freshman lights them up as if it were just a blessing that came out of the sky. Don't be stingy with your magic wand. Here's what I want you to do before we make a final decision about whether you want to be a senior leader. And they're sitting in a circle. Who changed your life when you were a freshman and they were a senior? And they go, Caroline Ainsworth. I said, someday someone's going to say your name in this circle. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. It is the best year you can possibly imagine. You live out Philippians 2, 5 through 11. We have the congregation commission the senior leaders. Senior leaders are leaders of each of the teams. Senior leadership dinners meet with the team advisors to work out the plans for the teams. Seniors lead team breakouts, they lead worship, they lead vespers. We never shout at the kids to be quiet. Caroline will say, seniors! And the seniors go, shh. If you're standing next to a senior and you're a freshman, you're going to be quiet. We don't have to shout at them because the seniors have their respect. Seniors have try to generate a budget where we can take a senior on a site visit to the mission site. So the senior engages the site and advises us on what they want to do, and then comes back and lights up the rest of the youth group and is in relationship with the youth group that we're going to engage with. And you can see the rest of it. Where it's migrated is we saw so much power in senior leadership that we started taking juniors. We will let them apply and write essays, and if they are accepted, they may lead our middle school youth group. Who's going to do that? Who has time? We now have too many to use, so we have distributed them as well into the junior youth group and the guppies and the youth worship. So by the time they become a senior, they've had 4 years of leadership of the younger kids. They have amazing leadership skills. All right, that's senior leadership. We'll take a short breakout and we'll come back. I think you could have said, could you have just sent me an email so I didn't have to come? I had a lot else to do. If the email had just said, whatever youth minister knows, relationship, 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 we would have gotten it. But the point of the next little segment is the real power of this is not just relationship amongst the kids, it's true relationship with the community we're joining with as partners, true relationship with the church we're going to, true relationship with their youth group, true relationship with the entire community. That's when this gets truly, truly beautiful. So how we find such communities and how we develop those relationships is what we're going to talk about next. We've got a little video where this has been just blessed. We had a mission trip to a Latino church, Centro Cristiano de Bethesda, in the Fullerton-Cicero neighborhood of Chicago. Amazing relationship broke out with them. They came and visited our church. We've now been on 7 mission trips with them to their sister churches in Guatemala and Puerto Rico. They have this amazing ability to express gratitude and engage us in ways that are, you know, no matter how loving you try to be, they top you. So at the end of the last mission trip, we do a worship service. We thank them as profoundly as we can. And then They had all learned a thank you song, the three-year-olds to the 80-year-olds. They went up and they were singing it. And while they were singing it to us, we had the spiritual insight of Kim Case, this young woman who just said, we should not be sitting in pews, we should come forward. And there was two communities, 80 each, falling into a massive group hug. We call it the miracle, El Milagro Continua. All right, little video from that trip.
But what was going on in that trip? And there was such a sense of unity. It didn't matter who was standing next to you. We were singing, we were hugging, we were dancing, and nothing else seemed to matter but what was going on in that church that day.
I've had the opportunity to participate in a lot of final worships, but I've never been in the presence of such amazing power and energy. Kneeling together, we sang from our hearts. Truly, we had become one.
When the YG community came together with the Bethesda community during the final worship, it was the most spectacular part of the trip. It literally moved me to tears.
Standing in that room, you felt an energy. I mean, the energy was love, and it was God's love pouring out of all of us.
Listening to them sing their thank you to us and then joining them up at the front, it was so special. We had really become one community.
We went to Chicago for 10 days, none of us having any real expectations of what we would encounter. The only thing that we really knew at the end of the trip, we had just experienced something amazing.
Well, we all know what the problem with that is. This is a gift of God or it's not, right? This is the Holy Spirit starts whipping around and everybody knows it and everybody is transformed by it. Is there anything we can do to nurture, create the possibility? I think we're back to Theologia Germanica. It's or Miroslav's Channels of Human Love with Luther or Leander Keck, Love, Love, Love. We have to seek where relationship, true relationship is possible. And here's a sin of mission trippers. You can't impose that on some community and say, we're coming, we're going to be in relationship. Guess what? It's a burden to have 20 kids suddenly in your church hanging out. You got to have meals together. You know, maybe they had something else to do. This is vocation for us. It has to be vocation for them. We have to prayerfully discern, are they called by God to be in partnership? And are we called by God to be in partnership? There has to be room for discernment, not great news, we're coming. All right, discernment is the first test. Next, not just do they discern that their own call is to be in partnership, but do they have an inclination and desire to be in real relationship? I've been on mission trips where they were delighted to have us come. We had terrific worship. We didn't see the pastor the whole week, which is fine. It's not his job to be our host, but maybe he wasn't his calling to be our host, right? Sometimes it is and sometimes it's not. We can look for places where the host wants to be in relationship, where the whole community wants to be in relationship. In Biloxi last year, 25 churches, all organized by that Hope CDA, wanted a festival week where the whole community could rise up and declare hope over against the despair of Hurricane Katrina. So the whole community made a gathering possible. It gets even better when it's the church. The least fruitful worship is we're on a mission site at a habitat place. We live by ourselves. We work on a site. We see no one during the week. And on Sunday morning, we bomb down to First Baptist Church of whatever, and we walk in as a surprise. They do the best they can to welcome us. We do the best we can to be in relationship with them. That's it. The best is if the church wants to be in relationship before you start and after you leave and all the time that you're there. And even better, Does the youth group want to be in relationship? Can we get a youth group to youth group relationship going? Now we get that, right? Now we get that. Not only do we want to have relationship on the trip, what is the possibility of enduring relationship? 7 mission trips with the same partners, to Guatemala, to Toa Alta, Puerto Rico, to Opelousas, Louisiana, to South Carolina, to West Virginia, together, right? That's when it gets rich, when we are partnering with them and going to a third site and living together and working together and in relationship. I'm going to pass over the rest of this except for 2 criteria. You know, I don't think our kids come into my church on Sunday morning with very high hopes of the worship. We have, a lovely mainline Protestant congregational worship form. And let's just say I don't see my youth group there in any significant numbers on Sunday morning. But there are communities and traditions. They love the worship, right? And they find it vibrant and exciting. That's a criterion, right? And then the final thing I want to add to this searching for the right partner is, you know, this whole country is populated by saints. These amazing, amazing people who have nothing, no Ford Foundation grant, no state grant, no big population in their church that's going to give them money, and they're doing amazing work because they get up every morning, they praise God, they pray, and they just go against all odds and serve. And then they do amazing things. I want my kids to see those saints. I want my kids to rub up against those saints. I want them to know that those saints exist who do not live in fancy houses, who do not have fancy cars, who do not have fancy funders, who have no security, but are doing amazing thing in God's name because it inspires all of us. All right, so that would be the other criteria I'd add on there. All right, nurturing relationship with this group once you find them. This is going to be different for everybody because it's obviously a budget issue. But if Puerto Rico is $275 round-trip airfare and you can possibly figure out a way to add another $275 to your mission trip so you can go to a site visit to visit that place and begin the relationship before you show up, obviously amazing. Can you find another $275 to bring their pastor up to your church for the Sunday you commission your kids for the mission trip and preach or talk to your kids and your congregation? Amazing. Can you find another $275 for one of their kids to come up so that their youth group and your youth group begin to have these little tendrils of relationship? I know it's a budget challenge. I'm just saying it's a good if you got somebody in your congregation who can write you a check for $275, so you can do it. You can see each of these things here are just elements on page 18 and 19 of laying down those gossamer strands of relationship that make the relationship authentic and create the possibility of true love and enduring relationship breaking out. During the trip itself, we structure the whole week around building relationship. Relationship, you know, Bruno Bettelheim says, nobody can do community by saying on three, commune. Right? Community happens as a byproduct of some other shared venture. So what we want is we want the shared venture to start when we get there. So a typical work week, for instance, when we were in Toa Alta, Puerto Rico, is we were working in a community, again, run by a saint. It's a tradition of squatters, a movement that began in Brazil, and it has migrated to other places in Latin America. Folks who are dispossessed just go onto public land, dig in and hold on, fight off the authorities, build their little shacks. At some point, the authorities don't want the shacks to burn down. They want there to be codes. They want there to be electricity, and they win. So that was the community we were going to. But you don't just show up on Monday morning to do the work. Let's have a community-wide breaking of bread and cleanup day where everybody works together. They get integrated into our work teams, so you have relationships breaking out around the work teams. Worship at the end of the day, praise God together, learn each other's songs. Sunday morning, come back and worship together for Sabbath worship, again in teams. Sunday afternoon, fellowship event. Their kids and your kids bonded up on teams. Remember, the way this goes is, if it's 30 of them and 30 of you, that's intense engagement, politeness, et cetera, for 45 minutes, then you run out of stuff to say and you start retreating back to your comfort zones. But if they're broken up so that they're on your work teams, so that they're working together, in relation together, breaking bread together, they don't have to have a commonality of what they had before the trip because they have shared experiences on the trip. So we want relational work going on all week long. On the work site, we want to integrate their contractors and their volunteers and their kids into our work teams on the work site if possible. Wednesday night worship together, which the youth run. If you've teamed up with the youth group, they probably are better at leading worship than we are. And our kids and their kids lead the worship together. Come back around to Friday. What our tradition is it's not for us to come and you tell us thank you. It's for us to come and tell you thank you. So our kids are servants of that community. They have a carnival for the children in the early afternoon. Then they serve and cook and tend tables to have a banquet for our host community that night, which segues into final worship, which you saw going on there. So that's the way we end on Friday night, trying to build relationship with our host community all week long. The next thing I want to talk about is how we develop relationship on work teams. You know, when I went on my first mission trip, what I saw was the kids would kind of bounce around during the week. They'd have fun social relationships at night. And then on Friday, when they had their final worship before going home, there was this amazing cathartic experience. Amazing cathartic sharing and trusting and worshiping and loving and hugging. And if they had worked together on a site, let's say at 18 kids, and there were six working at site A and six at B and six at C, those six, of course, were much more closely related because of their shared experience. All right, well, why are we waiting for Friday night? Why don't we front load this sharing in teams to at least the beginning of the week with nightly vespers? Why don't we front load it so the teams are vespering together, so the teams are running their own devotionals in the morning, so the teams are running their own prayers on their work site? Well, wait a minute. Why start at the beginning of the mission trip? Why not identify the work teams in October so that the team relationships and depth of the relationship is running all year long, building to the mission trip? Now, forming teams is more art than science, but the way we do it, and we've done it since we were only 25 folks, we click bust, right? We click bust. Mathletes and athletes, right? Goths and hipsters, we mix them all up. Seniors and freshmen. We mix them all up. What we tell each child is, write us a team preference card. You may identify one or two close friends. You'll be on the team with them, so you don't feel like I'm walking off into the unknown, all right? But beyond that, it's going to be mix and match. And then the youth ministers, knowing how the dynamics of these are likely to work, construct teams at the end of October, and we work with those teams all year long. When there's a breakout conversation in a youth group meeting, they break out as teams. When they are going to have different roles in worship, they break out in teams. When we're having games and competitions, they break out in teams. We start vespers in November and December, and they start to get used to the vesper and sharing tradition. We're laying down relationship all year long. By the time they get to the mission trip, you can have, instead of what the typical trip for me used to be, you can have a spiritual highlight of the Holy Spirit just blowing the doors off a group vesper on Tuesday night instead of that final catharsis on Friday night. So building teams, senior leadership of those teams, nurturing those teams all year long. Liza Bagley stood up at our 275th anniversary, and she was the child to speak to the congregation for our anniversary worship. And she said, I'm going off to college next year. I have no idea who I'm going to meet. I have no idea who I'm going to be thrown into. And then I'm going to go off to work, and through my whole life, I'm going to be thrown in one group after another, folks I don't even know who they are, and I won't know them when I meet them. I know something beautiful and wonderful is going to happen, because for 4 years, I have been in teams with people I started not knowing at all and who I love dearly, whether I had anything in common with them or not. I know God can do this wherever I go. That's the experience we want them to have, all right? And that's the ethos. Here's a little mission trip goal set. I saw one of our juniors heading off to a team meeting, and she had written her goals for the mission trip. We're on page 19. This was not something I had ever done, would do now, still don't do when I go off to clergy retreats, but she had written her goals and objectives for the trip. They were as follows. Don't have expectations. Keep in mind that the main goal is to let God serve through you. Don't hang out only with your friends. If you see someone alone, go sit with them and have a substantial conversation, not just a time filler. Never take the first shower. Never eat until you are sure everyone else will have enough food. Always look to lighten someone else's load. Don't only get to know people on your team, branch out. Make sure you are combined with the community. It's about them, not you. Make the experience a religious experience for you. Reflect on your experiences. Yeah, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. That's why we do youth ministry, right? That kind of grace can break out. I want to flip ahead to practices. The art of pilgrimage, read, you know, I've given you about 30 pages of excerpts of books on the theology and the anthropology and the practices of pilgrimages. The essence of pilgrimage was intentionality before you go, leaving your comfort zone, being on the road and in this liminal place, neither here nor there, where it's a thin space, right? Walking with folks with whom you share your lives as you walk, and engaging in practices all along the way of the faith that leads you closer to God, celebrating your arrival and your engagement at the destination, gratitude for the experience, practices on the way home, memorialize and reflect on what you have when you get back. Those are the practices of our faith. So we want to have thoughtful devotionals in the morning, and we want to have thoughtful vespers in the evening. We want to have them led by our seniors, because that's where we have our senior ownership. And the migration of this has been from random vespers to greatest hits vespers to, with Jonah Bartlett's help — where's Jonah, YDS grad? Jonah Bartlett's help. Jonah said, well, why don't we make the vesper week intentional? We'll have a theme we're going to drive through the week. We'll cover the theme on nightly shaped vespers, leaving room for the kids to bring their own self-disclosure and sharing. And we'll twin the evening vesper with the morning devotional. Right, woman who worked at our church, great educator, Ivy Beckwith — perhaps you've read her work. Ivy Beckwith says the way you shape understanding, the way you teach people to see the experience through the Christian lens, is prepare, engage, reflect. Right? When we had our first mission trips and there was amazing experience, I'd say, what happened, kids? And they'd go, what a high, what a rush, what a buzz. What were they shaped by? Drugs. Drugs. They had drug vocabulary, right? If you don't want them to have drug vocabulary for these experiences and you want to decode them according to what we understand the Spirit is doing, you have to prepare them to see what's going to happen. Then they engage in the experience, then they reflect on it afterwards. That begins to shape their understanding of what they've experienced. And the best way to do that is set up the preparation, the prepare in the morning devotional, and then do the reflection at the end of the day with the engagement in the middle. I mean, easy example, right? Matthew 25, least of these, right? You do the judgment of the nations as a devotional, and you set up the notion that where will you see Christ in the least of these amongst you? They go looking during the day for seeing Christ in their encounters, and they come back at the end of the day and they reflect, where did you see Christ today, right? Prepare, engage, reflect. The other thing I'd want to note is worship is obviously an important part of this, and that creates a little bit of a tension in worship, which is, you know, my kids would rather have a worship form that's very different from our church worship form. But if we're training them and habituating them to one form of worship that is completely disconnected to our denominational tradition, we're just preparing them to sail, right? So our integration is, the outside form will track the forms of our worship, but the style of the prayer, the style of the music, their own testimonies will shape in their own way the worship experience that they have. So that's kind of a summary of where we are in worship. Shall we take a little break, do a little workshop? All right, let's take 5 or 10 minutes. All right, beloved youth ministers. We have a very short but very important section, covenantal behavior. You remember I said that the three legs of our youth ministry stool are unconditional love and acceptance, clear and understandable boundaries and covenants, participation in something larger than yourself. I'm sure it doesn't take you more than a second to figure out that all these are part of turning away from self. Right? Each of these pulls you away from a self-centered, consumer, materialist life into community, into engagement with God, into covenant, into something larger than yourself. I used to think that the progress on building program was when we were on the offense. I hated when bad behavior or disruptions or conflict dragged us down. And I hated all the energy we had to put into having a safe and appropriate youth group. What I've come to think is actually the metaphor is more like field position in a football game. You want to go down the field on offense, but you do not want to give up ground on defense. Both are important. And the defense element of youth ministry is constructive buy-in around covenantal behavior. So you don't get thrown for gigantic losses when the kid goes off campus, smokes dope, you have to gather everybody, you have to do debriefs, you have to work it out, you have to have reconciliation, and you spend a day doing it, right? You'd rather you not go there, so covenantal behavior is important. I'm going to do just one out-of-sequence clip because this is a little bit... No, let's just pass on the clip. We'll pass on the clip. Covenantal behavior. Here's the way we have come to go after this. First of all, you know, Eric Erickson said, kids are built to recoil against authority. That's what they do in adolescence. They're individuating. They're built to beat you. They're built to escape the rules, right? That's part A. They're built to escape and recoil against rules they don't claim as their own. If they claim them as their own, they're actually rather Pharisaic about them, right? They're actually a little brittle. The trick in covenantal behavior, the aspiration, the mission, the yearning, is for them to own their own covenants of behavior, all right? Which requires that they be reasonable. Not if you clamp them down too much, you will provoke, force recoil, all right? Give them as much freedom as you sensibly can, keeping the boundaries clear and safe. Bright lines rather than blurred lines, communicated steadily. So, establish your ethos early and reaffirm often. Jack Welch, that great guru of youth ministry when he was president of GE, used to say, it's not enough to have a mission statement. You have to repeat it hundreds and hundreds of times for the culture to buy in to the vision. We have a behavioral covenant before they even sign up for the mission trip. They understand what it means. They have to sign each. It's a covenant. It's not a contract. It's a covenant. The parents have to sign the covenant. This is who we are. This is what we do. This is what we're about. We're not shy about having covenantal boundaries. We have a Ten Commandments presentation before every mission trip, and you can find the Ten Commandments in your notebooks. But here's the key. The seniors deliver the Ten Commandments, right? The seniors, of course, work it into a skit, and they work out a skit for each of the commandments, what the aspiration is and what not to do. If the seniors own the covenant, If the seniors own the covenant, the kids will own the covenant, all right? And the seniors present it because they own it. The gift of a zero tolerance policy, right? This is a little counterintuitive, right? But we have a zero tolerance for substances, cigarettes, stealing, sexual behavior. I don't mean appropriate sexual behavior, no sexual behavior, all right? You say, oh man, that's going to force a recall. They're going to hate that. They're going to try to beat you everywhere. You know what? Here's the little talk I give to them before the trip, and the seniors do the rest of it, but I say, you have incredibly difficult decisions to make every week about substances. Tough, tough communal peer decisions. We hope you make healthy decisions, and we're here to help you make healthy decisions. Guess how easy it's going to be for the next 10 days? No decisions. You're free. No decisions. You have really difficult decisions to make about what is and what is not appropriate sexual behavior with people that you have affection or love for. It's tough to make those decisions. I'm so glad I'm not a kid today. Here's how easy it's going to be for 10 days. No decisions. You know, I've gotten standing ovations at the end of that talk, and I always get a robust set of applause. What a relief. All this angst of being a teenager and navigating these questions, I don't have to for 10 days. And then they know. We catch you in the woodshed, you're going home, right? That's just the way it goes. And we have just done it twice in 20 years, but you don't have to do it more than that, all right? Clear and understandable and acceptable boundaries. The point of this I make to them is, we're about to have more fun than anybody should be allowed to have. This is going to be the most amazing experience we're ever going to have. We have this experience even though there are 150 of you and only a handful of us. You can beat us at any time you want on any of these rules. The only reason we get to do this is your parents trust that you won't. You want to do it again next year? We got to be on the same page. We got to be on the same page. Secret weapon, senior leadership. senior, when the seniors own these rules, it's the seniors' trip. They don't want the trip messed up by all those meetings and conversations and reconciliations. It's their trip. Favorite little story, we're on a ski trip, and a freshman who ain't quite on the program is reaching into his backpack and pulling out a joint. But he has the misfortune of being next to a senior. Senior, what are you, the biggest idiot in creation? This is my trip. Don't mess with my trip. What do you think? You know how bad this trip's going to go? Give me that. Don't you ever think of doing that again. You know how much more effective that is than me trying to police that rule? If the seniors own the covenant, nobody else is going to mess. Again, all a senior has to do is go, dude, that ain't cool. Done. It's over. Let the group own their own covenant of behavior, and we get different outcomes. Behavior on host sites. You know, our kids are used to traveling with mom and dad on tourist trips, etc., and they're used to being consumers. They go into the hotel room, how do they leave it? They go to the beach, how do they leave it? They got towels at the pool, how do they leave it? Nagging and shouting at them to be respectful of host property, whether it's a restaurant or a mission center, is a loser. What we want to convert is we want to convert them into being servants of the host. You're servants of this restaurant, you're servants of this recreational facility, you're servants of this mission center, you're servants of this church, and one of our services is going to be we're going to leave it better than we came. That's who we are, that's our ethos. All right? That converts the behavior on the site. The second thing we do with that behavior conversion is it never really works to say, so we're all going to keep the bathrooms clean and they're going to be clean at the end of the week. When everybody is responsible, who's responsible? Nobody. So our teams have daily responsibilities, and the advisor has that delegated, distributed responsibility. You're the advisor of Team A. Team A has the bathrooms. We don't move until the advisor checks in and says bathroom's clean. They own it, they're responsible, they get it. Advisors or your team advisors are responsible. Again, does it work if you just start this delegated responsibility on the mission trip itself? Of course not. That's too big a culture change. That culture of assigned responsibility is something that you ingrain all year long, and then it's set and forget on the mission trip itself. Clear and understandable boundaries. Kids own the boundaries and the covenants themselves. Seniors own the covenants so that they help you get there. We are servants of those that we eat with, that we worship with, where we stay, etc. And then finally, don't force recoil. Here are the two keys on not forcing recoil to me. Man, we have so many great things to do on a mission trip, so many opportunities for relationship, engagement, work, service, etc. If you overschedule the kids, they're just coiled springs needing to unwind. We have to have the discipline of letting them have time just to be kids. I don't know about your community. My kids are overscheduled in their home lives by a factor of 10. They don't ever get a chance to be kids. We very intentionally on a mission trip leave two-hour blocks of time, hour and a half block of time, just be stand down. We're not barking at you. You don't have to be anywhere. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to perform anything. Just be kids. Be in relationship. Have fun. Basketball court's there, swimming pool's there, card games going on over here, board games going over there, guitars playing down there. Just stand down. Give them space so that you don't coil the spring. The other thing that goes into this is, you know, you've all taken some good-hearted adult volunteers with you on a trip, and you say, I want everybody on the bus in 5 minutes, and the adult says what? I want everybody on the bus in 5 minutes. And then the other adult says, I want everybody on the bus in 5 minutes. And the kids are barked at nonstop. Right? Bark, 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 bark. What happens then? White noise. White noise. So the two things we try to keep in mind is try to figure out how parsimonious you can be about instruction. I don't really need their attention until that point. I'm not going to ask for it. Let it go until you really need to talk to them. Only talk to them when you really do need to talk to them. Tell them what they need to know. And then don't tell them again, all right? And don't let the adult volunteer, the team leader, the visiting advisor, don't let everybody pile on with the authority assertion. We're just beating them into a space where they're gonna wanna recoil against the space or tune it out. And again, with seniors, the way that looks is, all I expect Caroline or Jonah to have to do is go, seniors! And the seniors go, shh. And if you're standing next to one, you're still talking, the senior goes, shh. and we're done. Last thing I'd say, and I know these are really nuts and boltsy points, you shouldn't raise your voice if you don't have to. If you shout and they're not paying attention, you've taught them you'll shout louder and louder and louder and louder and louder, and they know they are incredibly tuned. They know when the tone is finally got to the point where they really have to pay attention, right? We don't want to train our kids in that. There should be mutual respect that you're not going to say something unless you expect them to listen. And when you do, they will. So if I said don't assert yourself any more than you have to, the next point would be never assert yourself unless you're going to get attention, right? I'm waiting. You know, what is a Ferris Bueller, you know? So don't ask for attention more than you need, and then make sure you get it when you have it. Okay, that's our covenantal behavior. We'll take another break. Beloved youth ministers, home stretch. Home stretch. 10 minutes on engagement with parents and home congregation. When I was beginning in ministry, we started a congregation-wide mission project, After School Enrichment. And the model that we used was the most phenomenal charter school I've ever seen, started by a fellow by the name of A.B. Whitfield in East New York. A.B. Whitfield brings passion, he brings energy, former Dallas Cowboy, cool, all right? And it's a phenomenal school in an incredibly poor neighborhood. And the kids achieve 3 grade levels above New York City public schools, et cetera. They all mostly get scholarships to move on from there. He has a rule. Every mom must pay $50 a month. The moms don't have $50 a month. How can you ask AB $50 a month from the moms? How can you do this? He goes, it gets me a little self-selection for moms who care and are invested in our program. Somehow, I got 600 kids here where mom found $50. Mom cares about the homework. Mom cares about what's going on because it's tough. All right? Now, we don't have that same community, but the point is, your kids in high school are making a lot of autonomous decisions about their time because they often have cars. Mom still has a lot to say about, is it youth group or travel soccer? Is it youth group or Olympic development? Is it youth group or SAT prep? Is it youth group or all-state band? Is it youth group or tutors? Is it youth group, et cetera? Well, mom's not being a bad mom. Remember Andy Root's question, why are moms like this? Because they love their kids. And in this culture, they have aspirations for opportunities that require a lot of hard work. So what is our answer? It can't be bad moms, you're not doing the right thing, you should turn them loose for youth groups, stop getting in the way of our developmental formation activities. We've got to convert mom into the value, dad into the value of the youth group. If I was talking about relationship for most of this talk, it means relationship with the parents too. Relationship with the kids, relationship with the advisors, relationship with the seniors, relationship with the host church, relationship with the host youth group, relationship with the host community, relationship with your own parents, and relationship with your own congregation. So we don't charge the parents $50 just to have the kid in the program, but we require that they come to a parents meeting at the beginning of the year. Oh, they don't have time for that, and they're not going to come, and they miss it. They have to come. The child does not go on the mission trip if the parents do not come to the parents' meeting or the makeup that we throw out there to try to give them a chance. And then we use the parents' meeting not really to just push bureaucratic paper. They can all read this if they want to know how the program works. We use the parents' meeting to lift up the beauty and the transformation and the value that's coming into their child's life if they'll support the time. We start with a little videotape. Where's Chris Scuda? There's Chris Scuda. He made all these movies. Killer videographer. Thank you, Chris. This is one of Chris's movies that we do to try to drive the values, unconditional love and acceptance, clear and understandable boundaries, participation in something larger than yourself for the parents.
Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road. And although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone.
'cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down, it'll all be clear. Don't pay no mind to the demons, they fill you with fear. The trouble in my drag.
You know the old Liz Lemon line, I want some of that, right? Parents look at the video and read the pamphlet that they got and they go, I get it. I wish somewhere in my child's life they had this. And then the fight over travel soccer, the festival of lacrosse in Northern Virginia, et cetera, we start to win those fights because the parents care and understand the values, the theology, the spirituality, et cetera. What else do we do? We have parents are required at that meeting to volunteer in several roles during the year to engage in helping the youth group, right? Engagement, this is our shared ministry. It's not, you know, one of the larger movements that you've read Mark DeVries' works and Chap Clark's is kids are not farmed out to youth ministers to learn the faith. It's primarily a parent's job, right? We're partnering with the parents and you're partnering with us by engaging as volunteers. We're moving towards parent adopted teams, probably not the team your child's on, but team parents. So when you have a team dinner, a team breakout, there's modeling for our children of adults in the church who are living lives of faith with whom they're in relationship and who care about them. We invite our parents. Tonight is youth worship. One of the things Caroline and Jonah have done is they've not just taken that we do youth worship once a month, but they've teed the high school kids up that they're leading worship for their younger brothers and sisters. So if you had high school worship and suddenly had nine-year-olds coming in, I think the high school kids would recoil, oh my gosh, we've got a bunch of little kids here. But if they're doing it for the kids, they're testifying, they're witnessing, they're preaching, they're praying, etc. They've bought this as one of their areas of service. And then Caroline and Jonah invite the parents to come to these worship services as well. And we start to get relationship between the parents and the youth ministry. We have an adult mission trip. Guess who 95% of the people on the adult mission trips are? Their parents. who go, man, my kid came home from the mission trip. I want to do one of those. And when they go on the mission trip themselves, of course, they're in relationship with the mission and values that their kids are in relationship with. All right, that's parents. Nurturing relationship with the home church. You know the old Ken DeCressy Dean critique that we are creating ghettos of our kids and they are disconnected from the church. The church misses this as well, right? The congregation that just farms the kids out and doesn't have anything to do with them doesn't feel engaged with the youth group. So we want a pattern and a habit and a practice of our kids engaging our home church. So we have YG Gives Back Days. We do a rake and run. We gather up any of the folks in the church who are having a hard time raking their lawns with fall leaves, and the teams distribute out on a Saturday. YG kids are on their way to you. It's not just to Biloxi, Mississippi. It's to our own seniors, all right, rake and run. The YG serves a pancake breakfast around all church meetings. And this year when we were all without power around Hurricane Sandy, we had a fellowship dinner where YG cooked a fellowship dinner for all those folks. Nobody had power. Everybody had been eating hash out of a can, but they came to the church and they got a spaghetti dinner served by, cooked by the youth group. And they go, we get it. This is youth group. It's not just somebody we're writing checks to. They're part of our community. We do the commissioning of the seniors in the meeting house in worship. Right? So you got 52 seniors and the parents go, congregation goes, yeah, they're ours. We're commissioning them off as missionaries. We commission the entire youth group for their mission trip in the meeting house at regular worship. And the congregation stands and covenants to support them in their mission, etc. We have, at the end of the trip, a Youth Sunday. You know, here are the three big days in our church during the year. Christmas, Easter, and Youth Sunday. Because when the kids come back from the mission trip and run the service, play the music, and testify, and five kids in a row stand up and say, my life has been changed by Jesus Christ coming into my life. I felt the Spirit in these ways. Where are the parents going? I want some of that, right? And so they are engaged with the youth group. We bust all the doors on Youth Sunday. It is the third largest. We have a significant number of adult members of our church who say, I joined the church because I visited on Youth Sunday, and I said, I want to be part of a church like this, all right? So that's the last point I want to make. Engagement, relationship, not only with the parents, but also between our youth group and the church itself. With that, we'll take one more break, and then we'll pray and go, all right? One more break. Okay, beloved youth ministers, seniors, thank you for coming. Thank you for what you do. We are in a world where we know the secret is, this is the most fun, fulfilling, a crazy cool thing to do in ministry, but the rest of the world doesn't necessarily affirm that, right? So sometimes it's lonely and we're out there on our own. I hope what comes out of this group is we're not lonely because we have each other and the opportunity to come and reflect. So thank you for what you do. One product placement is Michael Bird here. Today, my real job was warm-up act for Michael Bird, who is our next speaker. Amazing, cool program in an Episcopal church in Bronxville, where Michael has brought deep roots of Anglican spirituality into helping the kids develop a rule of life at the beginning of the year. They covenant, they're anointed, and then they live it out week to week. Michael's going to share spiritual formation and youth group and one of the great youth ministers in the country. So that's next month, right? Thank you, Michael. Yes? Yep, think so? We'll both check our schedules. Well, whenever it's going to be, it's going to be. He'll show up. All right. Don't forget Youth Ministry Initiative Fellows. Will the Youth Ministry Initiative Fellows who are here stand? Andrew D'Antonio, Elliot Munn, Kelsey Dallas, Kendra Joyner. These are outstanding, amazing Yale students who are working with our youth ministry. They get whatever they get paid as youth ministry team advisors, but the Youth Ministry Initiative gives them robust scholarships that go straight to Yale and help carry the load, all right? So that we can encourage folks who want to try youth ministry to go into it. Then they sit with me for an hour and a half of theological reflection on what they experienced during the week, hands-on plus reflection. You should have one of these at your church. We would be glad to pay for it. So come back to me about whether you'd like to have a fellow assigned next year, and if it's multiple churches, we'll all gather up here for the theological reflection. So thank you, Kelsey and Kendra and Elliot. Ask them later if this isn't the coolest thing they ever did, and I hope they'll still say yes, all right? Let's say a prayer. Gracious God, we know all these children were your children before they are our children to care for. We care for them in your name. and pray that we too would be open as channels to your love flowing through us into them, that they might experience the abundant life that you intend for them, that they might take hold of the life that really is life, that they might know that they are loved and come to love you in return. Bless to us into our ministries this week, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Thanks.